Today we're taking a slightly different tangent on Match of My Life. Massive football fan, but also a, I call him a celebrity chef, Paul Askew. Celebrity chef, is that what people call you, Paul?
I suppose they do. I don't think of it like that at all, but infamous chef maybe.
How do you become a celebrity chef? Is that when you hit sort of master chef or something like that?
Possibly, yeah. I suppose when you get to cook for lots of interesting people over the years and, you know, I don't know. It comes with notoriety, I suppose, but I don't think of it like that. I cook people's dinners at the end of the day, and
I just try
and do it at a very good level. That's all.
You brought your young son Harry in here. He's good at home as well, is he, Harry? Yeah, he just nods dutifully.
Well, he's ended up 2 foot taller than me, so must have been something to do with the diet, I think. But
did you set out with that sort of ambition in life?
Do you know, I did actually. Yeah, I spent a lot of time. My parents were in merchant shipping, which is why I first came to Liverpool. But we travelled a lot. I was at school in Dubai, then away in Singapore. Then I went off to New York as a sous chef. But I knew by about 15 or so that I wanted to be a chef, which is a bit strange, I suppose, in a way. But I've always had a passion for it. I think it's a passion for food culture, a passion for hospitality. I like looking after people.
Right.
I like seeing people have a good time.
So it's not just the process of making the food and being proud about that.
That's my route to making people happy, you know, but I'm a great believer of it's an all-round experience. You know, the food is a huge part of it and for me the most important part. But at the end of the day, it's good food, good service, hopefully some nice drinkies and of course good company.
All makes it, doesn't it?
It's about people having a good time. Absolutely.
You're part of this modern day culture, and you only have to turn your television on to see, you know, a host of famous names presenting culinary programs.
Yeah,
which has benefited the likes of yourselves.
It has very much. I mean, I when I started my training, you know, we were the sort of the servile wretches that nobody wanted to speak to. Whereas now it's like the new rock and roll. Everybody wants to meet the chef. Everybody wants to talk about where that food came from, how it was prepared. Why do you put that with that? And I spend as much time talking to people about recipes and production methods as I do about anything, you know. So it's nice that it's being glamorized. I think, you know, in this country we have a bit of an issue that it was never really treated as a true profession, whereas now it really is. And that needs to happen for the front of house as well. I hope we can, you know, do a bit more than Fred Siriex on date night and all that. You know, it needs something a bit more highbrow to get young people realising there's a massive career out there.
Do you scrutinise some of those programmes? Do you like
what, take the mick out of them?
I don't. You said it, not me.
Well, I do. I mean, to be honest, we don't see that much TV because we work
quite wacky hours.
But when I do, you know, whether it's Great British Menu, which I do like, recently MasterChef, things like that, I do watch them, and sometimes it's fabulous, but sometimes you think, hang on a minute, you know, it just feels like we're going in the slightly wrong direction, and there is a danger that, you know, the general public at some point will go, hang on, I've had enough of this. You know, we need a different approach, a fresher approach. But at the moment, there's a massive, massive appetite for it, isn't it? And I think it's because there's such a gap in our food culture. You know, I think Great Britain was sort of the laughing stock of the world at one point.
For food.
We were just so far behind because it was, you know, fish and chips and steak and ale pie, and you know that was about it. And then the, you know, the revolution of spaghetti bolognese, right? And yet now it's like the norm. You know, everybody's, my son, everybody's grown up with the desire for food culture, the desire to travel, the desire to understand why that comes from there, and why do you have that drink with that thing? And you know,
we've embraced it far more, haven't we?
Yeah, and I think it's because we knew there was such a gap. It was a bit odd at one point. You know, whereas I've studied sort of, you know, French classical cuisine, you know, even in North America, there's a huge culture because there's so many different nationalities there. The Culinary Institute of America is just incredible, you know. So it's interesting to see, and you can see it in our own city, can't you?
Oh, gosh, you know, completely. You know, I mean, the number of restaurants we've got now and the offering is unbelievable, isn't it?
It's staggering.
Could it be better?
Oh, I think so, yeah. I mean, I think we've come a long, long way, but I think there's still a ways to go. I think in numbers, we're growing all the time. In selection, we're growing. I think there still needs to be a bit more diversity. But I think the biggest thing is that there needs to be a few more ambitious independent restaurants. Just pushing a little bit and saying, you know, this is Liverpool. This is what we do here. A sense of identity. because food tourism is a big thing. You know, when we, let's be honest, when we go on holiday, what's the first thing we look to do? Where are we going to eat? Where are we going to drink? Where are we going to stay?
And
that's what Liverpool's becoming. You know, the visitor economy, as everybody calls it now. I just call it tourism. But food tourism is growing and growing, and that will be the major thing for Liverpool.
So in the future, more offering, more visitors, greater economy, greater boom for the city.
Absolutely, and I think we need to realise that there is a quality agenda behind that. It can't all just be, you know, pulled pork sliders and gourmet burgers and you know, there's a little bit of repetition out there, guys, if I may say. But I think if we were all a bit slightly more ambitious and embraced our local produce in the area and our local people, because we spend a lot of time trying to find the little gems who are from City of Liverpool College or We're All Met or St. Helens, or, you know, there's a lot of great people out there, but there's not a lot of people embracing them and mentoring them, and that niggles me sometimes.
Is it like looking for the next specialist footballer?
Are
there people out there who command a skill that you just...
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's so many sporting analogies. I mean, he'll probably start cringing now because I use rugby analogies or football analogies. And then, you know, I'd talk about the academy being, you know, the guys coming out of college or people who we've started at 16 on an apprenticeship. And we're trying to give them a grounding and, you know, every now and again they'll get a game in the first team. But, you know, you're going to be an acting chef de partie tonight on a section. But that doesn't mean that you're the chef de partie. You're just training to be. So it's a bit like when, you know, the right winger's injured, so you bring him off, they bring a young lad off the bench.
Give him a taster.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then you put him, hang on, you're not ready, we'll pull you back a bit. Yeah. It's exactly the same as that. And, of course, you have to have somebody playing up front on meat and fish.
Who's the star?
well, that's where it becomes
interesting.
You might
upset someone when you...
But that's very much like footballers as well, because the kitchens are full of egos and full of, you know, characters that need massaging, or some of them need a kick up the what's it. And, you know, it's that whole man management thing, like Klopp. I mean, I think of myself more as Klopp these days than I do as Robbie Firmino up front, you know, but it's very, very similar. It's about man management. It's about tying a team together to perform. You know, our performance is every lunch and every dinner. You know, we have two games a day, basically, which is... That's pressure.
And you have to meet a certain level every time
You have to, because people's expectations, you know, with knowledge and with passion for food, people's expectations are growing and growing. And we're doing that because we want to be at the forefront of it. We want to push the levels. Mm. Just as Liverpool want to be top of the league, you know, we want to be top of our league. And that's what we're doing, you know. So it's... you make your own pressure, actually. It's quite bizarre. It's like self-harming.
Oh, God.
It's a bit...
Have you worked in a few Hell's Kitchen environments?
Yes.
Does that really exist?
Sadly, it does. Yes, it does. I mean, obviously, I won't name names of particular kitchens or restaurants, but there is still a culture of... You know, you could argue it's bullying. You could argue it's torture or whatever. It's referred to as beasting in the industry, and what it is, it's a bit like joining the Royal Marines and trying to learn ballet at the same time. It because they're two conflicting skills. You need military discipline in a kitchen, but you also need creativity and something a little bit different. And you know, and they're not natural bedfellows, those two skills, are they? So what they do is they keep pummeling you with really tough jobs as a way, a test of character, if you like. Because at the end of the day, the cardinal sin in our business is if you fail in the middle of service or you walk out in the middle of service or you stop, you know, you stop performing in the middle of service. It's like somebody in a game. You can't just stop. You play until the end of the game.
It's like being on radio, wouldn't it? You just can't leave in the middle of the show.
No, exactly, yeah. Who's going to carry it? So the show must go on, sort of thing. So it's... That's why they do it, but of course they take it to the nth degree, and unfortunately we lose a lot of good people from the industry because of that. And the days that, you know, I mean, Gordon Ramsay's persona is very much, you know, a TV thing, but to get to three Michelin star level, he would argue that that's the way you have to be. It is like, you know, it's life and death scenario, not we're cooking somebody's tea, you know.
But so, are you the polar opposite to that?
I think I've become that. I don't think I was that when I was 25, 30. Yeah. I think I was pretty much similar to that, actually. But I think, you know, the modern world is about sort of nurturing and building confidence and, you know, showing people the way rather than bullying them and pushing them and demanding them and damaging them, in my opinion, which has been what's happened in the past. And let's be honest, there's a huge shortage of people coming into the industry. So we need to show that there's a different way of working, and that, you know what, this is really good fun as well. We can have really good fun, and yes, it's long hours, it can be antisocial hours, but there's a great satisfaction at the end of it, you know. So it's
and you can become a celebrity chef. We're talking with Paul Askew, chef patron of the Art School restaurant, of course, one of the best places you're going to find. We'll talk a little bit about your previous working environment, because there's a great story which links into your Match of My Life a little bit later on. But tell us a bit about the Art School, and obviously you put so much work into the Art School to create something absolutely unique for the city.
It is, really. I mean, for me, it's been a labour of love right from the beginning, and I suppose this is the restaurant I've wanted to do since I was 16 years old. It's an amazing building, you know, lovely spot in the Georgian Quarter. Couldn't have asked for a better. It was completely derelict when we got hold of it, but I think for me, it's bringing all my 30-odd years experience into its purest form, if you like, and trying to get the details. Because like any good business, it's the devil is in the detail, isn't it? It's the same for you every time you do a show, you research and all the stuff that goes into it behind the scenes. But this, for me, is about the customer experience, as I said before, as much as the food, as much as the drink service, as much as the champagne bar underneath that we've just opened, as much as the private dining room that's a very personal space. You know, it's all very much me, but it's designed completely to give people the best possible dining experience that they can have. And, you know, my dream was to always bring capital city standards to Liverpool. Because we've been, you know, we didn't get great press for many years, did we? Let's be honest.
That's true, isn't it?
You know, there was a lot of perception change needed, which for me started probably when I came back from New York in 95. And I worked for the Royal Philharmonic Society. I opened the little restaurant underneath, did all their backstage catering, did all their outside catering, did all their, you know, whether it was Buena Vista Social Club one minute or Joan Baez the next or Nina Simone, or, you know, so he got to cook with all these people and cook for the Queen, and, you know, and you start to build this sort of persona, if you like, and this sort of, as you would call it, celebrity chef thing. But
and confidence for doing it at that level.
Confidence and just being flattered to be asked to do those things as well. But it's, I suppose what it does each time you do something like that, it gives you the confidence, it gives you the, you know, the will to do it again, but a little bit better. And there's a big adrenaline rush. It's just like a game. Just like you're waiting for the whistle to blow on a Saturday night and you've got 80 covers booked for dinner and it's game on. You know, it's
can we do it?
Yeah.
Pressure's on.
Yeah. Can it be a perfect service? Can it be faultless? You know, that's what we're... It's so similar, honestly. That's what we're all about. But the Art School, I think we captured a moment in the city where, you know, the regeneration is still pushing and there's lots of investment coming in. I think we're lucky in that, you know, the people of Liverpool have embraced what we've done. But there's still a ways to go. You know, again, I don't think we're the finished article yet. I still think there's another couple of layers.
Never think you're finished. Already got the Christmas menu out. So if you want to have a little look at the festive season at the Art School, it's the nicest brochure you're ever going to see. Pop by and pick one up. I'm sure these are on the front reception,
aren't they,
of the Art School.
Yeah.
Just in case you're wondering maybe where to go over Christmas, that the menu just sort of blows you away. Have a little look at that. We're going to do a Match of My Life with him very shortly indeed, because he's got a great football cooking related story, if that sounds plausible. Paul Askew is our guest today on Match of My Life. Match of My Life today is with Paul Askew, who's the chef at the Art School restaurant, the patron, of course, one of the most popular restaurants about in the Northwest. And you've had a love of football ever since you
Absolutely,
were
a
young lad, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Where did that start?
Well, a lot of it'll sound funny, this, but we moved to Liverpool when I was about 4 and a half, so we're all Mackhams by birth. We're all from Sunderland. So my early memories of my father still being demented, because, as you know, Sunderland have very little success at any time. But, of course, 73 Cup final, I was probably only about seven years old or something like that, 7 or 8. And my dad literally went to the match and disappeared for about 3 days because, of course, you know, the famous Ian Porterfield save from Jimmy Montgomery and Bob Stokoe leaping around with his hat on across. So I am still a Macken by birth and in my heart as well, because it's hard not to be with, you know, the way it is up there. But my God, they've suffered and suffered, haven't they? We just keep praying that somebody, like, you know, we need another Peter Reid to go back and sort them out or something. But as a result of Sunderland's demise, of course, I fell in love with the Mighty Reds, and all my mates at school were all sort of big Liverpool fans as well. And I've been lucky, and throughout my career, I've always ended up being able to go to games every now and again. Never been a season ticket holder or anything like that, but I've been quite a lot. And of course, latterly, through the chefing career, we got the chance to look after the team a lot, like a real lot. And when Rafa and Paco Estarán came to Liverpool, which was a big deal, wasn't it? A big time and
massive, wasn't it?
And a huge sort of change in the way Liverpool were thinking and doing things. And of course, they lived at Hope Street Hotel in the Carriage Works, where I was at the time.
So your relationship to that hotel at the time was what? Were you?
I was the chef, and I was the food and beverage director and a shareholder at the time. So it was a big deal for Liverpool as well, because it was the first sort of boutique hotel, the first, you know, perceived as the first sort of
classy, higher end
restaurant
hotel.
And,
yeah,
and of course we were still in, you know, Hope Street is on the edge of Toxteth, so it was great times and a great leap of faith, you know, which you do need to do in our business quite often, but we, you know, it's still doing amazingly well now. It's going from strength to strength. They're expanding again now, putting a spa in there and loads of extra bedrooms and apartments. It's just growing. But the tradition that Rafa started was that he would gather the team at the hotel, so away from Melwood, away from the club, but he wanted them there to have a meal together before they go to Anfield for the game. So, of course, this was great for us, because they were sort of living in the hotel every new signing that came from Spain or anywhere. Rafa would put them in the hotel until they were housed. And they were just great, great, exciting times. And the city was on the beginning of the regeneration trail towards capital of culture. And, you know, and of course, in this particular instance, the game, it was the road to Istanbul. Not that we knew that at the time, but it was to be a very special time in the city, and for in our world, the regeneration, the hotels, the restaurants, it was just at the start of when things were starting to
bubble up nicely.
Yeah, it was amazing.
The club must have had a lot of confidence in the hotel to deliver the correct food. Obviously, diet and nutrition is everything to the modern day football. So, what sort of hoops did you have to jump through to convince Rafa or Liverpool we'll feed them correctly?
Yeah, do you know what? I think it was largely driven by Rafa himself and Paco. I think that because they'd spent quite a lot of time in there and had a lot of meetings in there, then their families would come and stay there. And I think they got to know that we were very passionate about looking after people, and the food was all fresh orientated, all in, obviously I'm bound to say it, but in my opinion, pretty good. And they just thought, right, this is the perfect place to do this. Let's get it started, sort of thing. And, you know, the excitement for the staff and the excitement for the whole street, really. You know, to see the team bus parked outside and, you know, getting ready for each game. And it's a tradition that still goes on, you know.
Did you have that every time? There was a particular sort of self-buzz?
Well, yeah, because as we were chatting before, you know, for me, you get a... Every player has different dietaries and different preferences. So you imagine, and the managers too, by the way. So you imagine before a meal, you feel responsible. You want to put your energy into that food. And in my crazy mind, you know, I'm thinking, right, this'll change his performance tonight if I get this back. Do you know what I mean? But that's how chefs think. You know, it's. And of course, if you get it wrong, then you think you might affect his performance in the wrong way. So. You really do get entwined with the food. You know, it's like every plate I send off the pass, I'm thinking, you know, I'm always asking, I'm looking to see if plates are coming back empty and cleaned and mopped with the bread. Because that's what chefs, that's our job satisfaction, knowing that we've passed a little bit of this from our hearts onto the plate and to the, in this case, the players. So, of course, that's where the obsessive behaviour of a chef comes from and wanting to do it well day in, day out, you know. But when it's a significant game, and of course the one we're about to talk about is the, you know, semi-final of the Champions League. No pressure, right?
The pressure's ratcheted up, isn't it? Let's talk about your match of my life, and it is, of course, Liverpool-Chelsea, 2005, semi-final of the Champions League. There's been a the goal of straw at Stamford Bridge, and Liverpool were in a territory that you could never imagine. So, basis, you're absolutely
on cloud 12, aren't you?
Exactly.
And if I remember, it was sort of real David and Goliath stuff in that Chelsea was something like 30 odd points ahead of us or something. Mm. It was ridiculous. They were champions, everything was going their way. And of course, Mourinho was at his belligerent best and trying to play the mind games before the game. Rafa was having none of it. And the build-up to the game was just bonkers. I remember it very well. And there was there was tension at the hotel before they left. You could see that. You know, but in a way, it was sort of, I would describe it as a buzz of anticipation rather than nervousness. They weren't nervous. You could see that they wanted to get stuck into them, you know, and that was really good seeing them go off on the bus. So that you see them get on the bus, and then I'm hopping into a cab to get to Anfield in time.
You fed them, and now you're chasing them.
I fed them, and now I'm chasing the bus down Hope Street. Yeah, it's bizarre, isn't it?
But and at the time, Luis Garcia was still living in the hotel in the carriage.
That's
works.
Right. He hadn't found his house or anything at the time. So you do, you know, anybody who stays with us, you know, or you look after, you feel that you want to look after them, you feel responsible for them. And that's what true hospitality is. That's what our industry is all about, you know. And whether that's from a nutritional point of view or giving them a quiet room to go and chill out in or whatever it is, you know. So it was amazing. And, of course, the other thing was we got quite close with Paco and Shabby because they're both Basques from San Sebastian and obviously massive foodie area. So I'd sit and have a chat with Paco about... if he wasn't talking about football, he'd be talking about food, you know. And then, of course, you get to know Shabby. Unfortunately, he was suspended that night, so he couldn't play. And then Didi Herman was drafted in, a very noble and...
Quite a capable replacement.
Nice to have somebody like him to drop in there, wasn't it? But amazing. And, of course, you mix that in with Stevie G and Carragher. And, you know, amazing mix of characters, really. Really, really, really strong. You know, I remember it being a really tight group.
Was dinner time on that day or afternoon meal? What time do they eat before they headed off to a Champions League semi-final? Was it in any way different?
Two and a half, 3 hours before, really.
Right.
And then they have a little walk and chill out and sometimes...
Walk
the food off, chill out, have a bit of a massage or preparation before the game. And usually a meeting as well, obviously. Mm.
Come on, the menu must be stuck in your head from that day. You're not telling me you don't remember what you fed them to get to a Champions League final.
I'll be honest, I don't.
You
know,
don't?
Because the dietaries would change depending on mood and depending on whether they'd had previous games that week. And, you know, sometimes they're nearly always loading up on carbs the day before. So a pre-match meal is usually just very light and high protein and just a little bit of... I mean, some people just have a bowl of porridge. Some people just have scrambled egg on toast. Mm. Some people want a fillet steak cooked in a certain way, sliced in a certain way on a certain side of the plate. And a bit sort of superstitious and, you know, and the pasta had to be cooked out. You know, each one of them had little quirky things, which you get to know. But you just remember... For me, it was just that there's extra tension for us because, come on, this is a bloody important game. Let's make sure that every detail is absolutely bang on, which, to be honest, is what we do every day.
So you got all the staff round and made a particular point of saying...
Oh, yeah. I mean, we have a briefing, you know, every day in service, but for something like this, you know, you've got to... We place the same importance as they would be, you know, so it's sort of... It's bizarre, isn't it, when you think of it like that? But that is what happens, yeah.
And of course, quite influential, as you say, on what they actually do on the pitch in terms of their energy and the fuel they've got in them.
Well, that's what we. But you know, in my head, I'm imagining what effect, you know, this food. You know, if we get that absolutely bang on perfect, then he's going to leave that room feeling a little bit better, a little bit nicer, thinking, God, that was spot on tonight. That's what we think. They might just shovel it down and go out and be thinking about something completely different, but I don't think so.
No, you played your part.
Yeah.
What do you remember of Anfield that night or turning up to Anfield? Were you on your own? Were you with someone else?
Or? Yeah, I was on my own, actually, and we just sort of... It was a spur-of-the-minute thing because I didn't think I was going to be able to go as well. That was the other nice thing for me in that I could escape and go to the game. But I just remember that walking in, and I was quite late. It was just literally just before You'll Never Walk Alone was beginning. And it was a cauldron. I've seen some games there, and I've seen particularly Champions League games. And it's always different, isn't it? There's always another level of sort of decibels. But this was just like because I think there was so much passion, and it was probably anti. It was a bit anti Chelsea and a bit anti Mourinho, because he's always, as we all know, quite a self-confident gentleman, isn't he? To put it mildly. And of course, the Chelsea, you know, you ain't got no history and all that was kicking off. And it was just an absolute cauldron. And they were just chanting, "We are the champions, we are the champions." And we're like, yeah, whatever. You know, so, but I don't think You'll Never Walk Alone was sung any louder or any more passionate ever than that.
I don't think it ever has been, has it?
I read something afterwards. It's something like 130 odd decibels or something. Absolutely incredible. And it just, the hairs on the back of your neck stand up, there's tears in your eyes, and it's just so powerful, isn't it? So, I mean, the big story that night was that everybody said that, you know, it was the fans that sucked the ball into the goal, wasn't it? And you could almost feel that, and no wonder the journalists felt that as well, because it was like no other feeling. Absolutely incredible.
Yeah, there have been some remarkable nights at Anfield, but I think that one, for anyone who was there, stands out for the sheer emotion.
It really
and
was,
probably the impact that it had on the players as well.
I think, well, they couldn't fail to be carried on with the energy from that. And it was a very cagey, tight game again, wasn't it, if you remember? I mean, obviously, when the goal was given, there was still, I don't know, 20 minutes, 25 minutes, maybe even a bit longer to play. And I remember, even right at the last minute, Gudjonsson had a shot, and Dudek had to, you know, get down and make pull off a fantastic save. But my God, the nail biting finish. And then I think there was a ridiculous amount of extra time pulled up as well, and that everybody was going no, because of course, you know, Chelsea, you can never write them off. They still had a lot of strong player. Drogba was still in there.
Gudjonsson, of course, Johnson, who had that shot, and they arguably they were a much better team than Liverpool. Well, if you looked at the man for man.
Well, at the time, you'd have to say, on paper, they should have won, shouldn't they? And they were certainly favourites with the bookies and everything. But again, you can't write off the Anfield factor, and you can't write off the power of the fans behind us. You know, it's just.
You're never quite prepared for a night like that, are you?
No, God, no. And it was such. I remember the euphoria after the game as well. And of course, the first thing you want to do is go and have a pint, isn't it?
Yeah.
And celebrate. And
How did you celebrate?
Exactly that. I went back to the hotel and we had quite a few pints, actually. And we didn't see any of the team.
Yeah.
But staff and fellow colleagues, we were there having a drink. And it was quite, you just sort of sat there thinking, oh my God, we got to the final against Chelsea. We weren't supposed to do this, you know, but it was incredible. And then, of course, as we all know, the road to Istanbul was, it was as if it was written after that game, really, you know, to the controversy of some people saying the ball wasn't over the line and, you know.
Just added to the mystique of the final.
Yeah, and the old cliche, all the names on the trophy and all this. Well, it really was, wasn't it? And then when you see what happens in Istanbul, you know, 3-0 at half time and then they come back and it's penalties. I mean, it really was written on the trophy, wasn't it? So it's.
Did you have a few moments with Lewis? Not that night, but in the weeks that followed? Or the manager?
Yeah.
Or were you in their ears?
Very much so, yeah. Oh, God, yeah. I mean, it was just incredible. I mean, I couldn't go to Istanbul, but we had a... You won't like this, but Radio 5 Live decided to camp out at the hotel.
Well, that's
and
all right.
And it should have been you, shouldn't it? But and they did their live broadcast from the cellar, from the residence lounge bar underneath. And all the legends would come and have interviews and stuff like that. But it just went on and on and on. But it was quite a few months before Lewis moved out, and it was great. Honestly, really nice people as well. Very, very professional. Very down to earth. You know, not your sort of enfant terrible type footballers. They were really really friendly, genuine people. And I think that was. That was the Rafa style and that was the Paco style. It was very much, you know, let's keep it real. And, you know, we're footballers. We're here to do a job for these fans. And it was very much about the club and about the people. It wasn't how important am I? Look at me. I'm a posh footballer. You know, it wasn't like that at all.
No, but interestingly, as a footballer moving to a different city, you've got to be comfortable, haven't you? We hear a lot of footballers who get homesick or edgy. We heard of Mourinho unhappy living in a hotel.
Absolutely.
But, you know, in Garcia and Alonso, two players massively fulfilling their potential, but actually maybe living in a hotel in what people would say should be an uncomfortable environment, but they're very much at home in the centre of Liverpool.
I think, and again, I'm not just saying this, but I think the hotel... the whole culture of the hotel and the philosophy of the hotel was very much about putting your arm around people and looking after them and protecting them, and you know, and you'd have press outside all the time trying to weasel their way in, and it's quite hard, you know, it's quite hard to manage an environment where you've got public coming in and out, as well as, you know, they're still you know, they're still the same human beings as everybody else, but they have to be looked after in a different way. And that's, again, not about the importance of them, because I don't like all this sort of celebrity, oh, he's better than you because he's a celebrity. I don't like all that, but you do have to, because they come with a different set of rules, if you like. So it's but I think we got that right with it, and they felt that, you know, they felt that we were pushing the boat out to make sure that they were comfortable, and I guess that's why it's carried on, and still to this day they're doing a great job. And
I wish you'd caught it all on video, you know, like the Manchester City documentary.
I know,
I remember as a journalist at the time when Rafa joined, a friend of mine who's a very prominent journalist now gave me a tip before anyone had released it that Rafa was joining and that he was coming to the Hope Street. And actually, I rocked up and saw Rafa walking there when it hadn't yet even been announced that he was the replacement at the time as manager. And that still lives in my memory, that image of Rafa going in there and thinking, oh, is that the new manager? Who is he?
Great. I mean, a great appointment, wasn't it? You know, and I think if, in all honesty, probably Rafa still feels there's unfinished business there, doesn't he? I think bit of a shame the way it all fizzled out in the end, because he deserved better than that, I think. But you know, he won the Champions League for Liverpool.
He didn't do badly, did he? Let's finish off and go back to the chefing,
the nuts and bolts. Yes.
The what's it the all madness, about? Absolutely. Madness. So the art school must have had a few famous faces in here.
Yeah, we have. We've done all right. Well,
open the book. Who's liked it?
Do you know what? The most significant one, and it's a shame because he's passed away now, was John Hurt.
Wow.
Who came for dinner one night, and he'd been filming in Liverpool, and I was lucky enough to cook for him a couple of times before, actually. But you know, it's bizarre when you see faces. You know, one minute he's in Ollivander's wand shop in Harry Potter, and the next thing he's walking in ordering off your tasting menu. It is quite bizarre sometimes. But we tend not to sort of name who's been in that recently. I mention him because it's always a little nod to him, but we're very lucky in that we attract.
Yeah, and we're obviously a major film destination, so you might get a few through the doors at the moment.
The way the city's going, it's the next, Warner Brothers are still supposed to be coming, and all sorts of stuff going on, isn't it? Incredible. It's just great to see the city in this current position, isn't it? And using the assets and moving forward, and just exciting times. Definitely.
I know what went wrong before the Real Madrid game. Now, you didn't cook for them, did you? This is the problem. You know. Liverpool Football Club, get Paul back on the case there.